Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues, welcome. I am Zdeněk Hanzálek, and you are watching the 28th installment of the scheduling seminar. Today, I'm happy to introduce Maurice Queyranne. He is Professor Emeritus of Operations Research and Logistics Division with Sauder School of Business at University of British Columbia, Vancouver, Canada. He is interested in combinatory optimization, production planning and scheduling, and supply chain management. He did his PhD in Grenoble, at the University of Grenoble, and he started at École Polytechnique de Montréal. And then he went to College of Business at the University of Houston in Texas. So, Maurice, welcome, and the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you, Zdeněk. So, good afternoon for most of you, good morning for some of you. So today I will talk about some work that I've been associated with on polyhedral approaches to scheduling problems. So this is work, joint work with a number of co-authors that I will reference during the talk. So let's see. So as a prelude, so why are we interested in scheduling polyhedra? Well, it comes from the formulation of scheduling problems as mathematical optimization problems, and primarily as integer linear optimization problems. So when you set up a formulation for a scheduling problems, the primary decision that you face is which variables to use. And in the abstract, and also in a survey that we wrote with Andreas Schultz some years ago, we identify five types of variables, start date and completion dates variables, which are continuous variables, and then more binary variables, such as linear ordering variables, traveling salesman variables, assignment and positional date variables, time index variables, and so on. And there are others. So once you've decided which variable or combination of variables to use, then the next the consequence of that is that you want to represent the feasible sets of variables which are associated with feasible schedules. So you want to introduce constraints that represent or approximate this feasible set. And these, when the constraints are linear, then they define polyhedra. And the study of this polyhedra, which is what we'll discuss today, yields structural and algorithmic insights. So in this talk, I will emphasize two sets of variables that I've been working on, the start dates and completion date variables on one hand, and towards the end, some examples of time indexed variables. So let's start with this date variables. So in this type of formulations, the decision variables are the start times or the completion times of the jobs or the operations when a job consists of several operations. So these are continuous variables. Because they're continuous, that they do not capture the combinatorial structure of scheduling problems, particularly for non-preemptive scheduling problems. And one particular and important type of constraints or restriction on scheduling problems is the non-overlap condition, that if you have two operations that are on the same machine, on the same resource, they cannot overlap. So we can model using, for example, disjunctive constraints, which express the disjunction that if you have two operations, I and J, one must be completed before the other one can start. So this is expressed by the disjunction at the bottom of the screen. The start time, the difference in start time between the operation J and I is either at least a certain positive quantity dij, which we will call the delay. So the difference dj minus ti is at least dij if J starts after I is completed, or conversely, if I starts after, then Ti minus Dj is greater than or equal to some delay Dji. So this delay may include the processing time of the first operation, and possibly a switchover cost when that happens. And with these general disjunctions, we may model release dates by adding an operation, a dummy operation zero that starts at time zero, and the release date defines the delay. We can model precedence constraints by setting one of these, let's say it's J, then the delay from between J and I is infinite, which makes these second term of the disjunction infeasible, so the disjunction reduces to a single linear inequality here on the start times. This type of formulation was introduced or considered from a polyhedral point of view in a landmark paper by Egon Balash, published in 1985 on the facial structure of scheduling polyhedra. Balash was motivated by job shop scheduling he was interested in, particularly in steel making. In this job shop scheduling problem, each job consists of a sequence of operations, non-preemptive operations, and each operation is on a specified machine. And in the problem that Balash considered, the objective was a makespan, so the time to complete all the work that had to be done. He formulated this problem as finding a critical path in a disjunctive network with operations as nodes and arcs, and two types of directed arcs that represent constraints on pairs of operations. So you have precedence arcs, which relate to operations on the same job, because the job is a sequence of operations. And then we have disjunctive arc pairs that correspond to a machine, which enforce the non-overlap condition. So for every two operations, I and J, on the same machine, then you have such a disjunctive pair. One of the jobs must, one of the operations must be before the other. So a selection specifies a choice for each such disjunctive pair. And once you've made a complete selection, then the problem reduces to a critical path calculation on the resulting project network. Now all the disjunctions have been resolved, and what you have is just a precedence constraint problem. And that takes care of the machine schedule. So in this paper, Balash has a number of basic results, fundamental results. First, he observes that the set of all feasible start time vectors T, so T is a vector with one component for each operation. And this, the set of feasible start vectors, is the union of polyhedra. And each polyhedron is full dimensional and unbounded. And there is one polyhedron for each selection, or for each feasible selection. Why are these polyhedra full dimensional and unbounded? Well, because we have to take into account the possibility of inserting idle time before any operation. So the scheduling polyhedron is the convex hull, or more precisely, the closed convex polyhedra are unbounded. And the main focus in this paper is on the single machine problem with release dates and without precedences. So in other words, the scheduling polyhedron is on a click, which corresponds to the disjunctive constraints on that single machine. Every pair of operations must not overlap. Balash identifies extreme points as feasible schedules, so minimal in the sense of having the least idle time. The extreme rays correspond to the idle time insertion. And since we can insert idle time before any operation, then every ray, that implies that the polyhedron is full dimensional and unbounded. And the focus is on the facets. Balash identifies facets with small support, with a very small number of operations, and also a general method of lifting facets from subclicks to from subsets of operations to bigger sets. And then he gives a generic separation algorithm. These ideas were tested by Applegate and Cook. They implemented the Balash's separation algorithm for cuts with small supports, with small subsets of operations, at most five of them. And this idea was generalized, the idea of generating facets or sets of variables as Fenchel cuts and local cuts in Applegate and others work on the TSP. Applegate and Cook compared the results from these formulations on 10 by 10 instances, which were the classical challenging instances at that time, with the bounds that were obtained by combinatorial arguments from Carlier, and also on the so-called basic cuts with larger support by Dyer and Woolsey. And the result was modest reductions in integrality gap. Part of the reason why these reductions were modest was that the objective was a make-span objective, which makes the polyhedral type of approach a bit less attractive. We'll come back to that. So when we looked at these problems and these formulations, and the somewhat mildly disappointing results, we wondered whether there would be other ways to look at these problems. And an inspiration comes from the polynomial time equivalence of optimization and separation, the classical result of Kulcher, Lovash, and Shriver. And this result suggests that if you have a family of polyhedra, it may be easier to describe when the associated linear optimization problem, so minimize some objective, any objective over that polyhedron, any linear objective, when that problem is solvable in polynomial time for any objective weights. So that's sort of equivalence of the optimization and the description of, or rather the separation problem for the corresponding inequalities. So I will describe a little bit of the corresponding results using completion time variables instead of stop times, as in Balash. That's just a simple fine change of variables, but it's more appropriate because the objective is usually expressed in terms of completion time variables. And the linear objective is simply means sum objectives, a weighted sum of job or operations completion times. So let's start with the simple results on one of the simplest possible machine scheduling problem. On a single machine, that machine can process only one job at a time. So that's, we have to enforce the non-overlapping condition between any pair of jobs. We have n jobs, they're all available at date zero. They have known processing times and they have known weights. And we want to find a schedule of these jobs to minimize this mean sum objective. Now, this is a very classic problem which was solved in the 1950s by Wayne Smith, who shows that it's optimum to process the jobs as soon as possible, so no idle time, and in increasing order of the ratio of processing time to weight. So here I assume that the weights are strictly positive. Right. And by increasing, I mean any non-decreasing order of these ratios works. This rule is very well known. It's here I will denote it as the WSPT rule, weighted shortest processing time rule, because if the weights are all equal to one, then it's simple. This reduces to shortest processing time. In stochastic scheduling, it's known as the CMU rule, and it's a form of a Keating index. So for this simple problem, we can describe exactly the convexal of the completion time vectors of all the feasible schedules. It's a polyhedron, as follows from Balash's result. But this polyhedron is described explicitly by a family of inequalities. We have an exponential number of inequalities, one for each non-empty subset of jobs. And this inequality is of the following form. So for that subset of jobs, if we take the sum of the product of the processing time and the completion time of a job, something that may sound a bit odd, well, this quantity must be greater than or equal to a function of the set and the processing time, which is given here. So half the square of the sum of the processing times plus half of the sum of the squares of the processing times. And in addition, if we're not interested in idle time, if we look at the permutation schedules without idle time, without preemption, then the convexal of this set is precisely the facet of this polyhedron PG, where the constraint corresponding to the whole set is an equality constraint instead of being an inequality. So that characterizes this convexal of the completion time vectors for that simple possible polyhedron. This characterization has some interesting properties. The right-hand side function G that we had in the previous inequality is supermodular. It satisfies the supermodular inequality, that if we take two job sets A and B, then the sum of the values at the union and the intersection is greater than or equal to, that's the supermodular part, the sum of the value of the function at the two sets. And therefore, the scheduling polyhedron is up to an affine transformation, what's known as a supermodular polyhedron that have been thoroughly studied. And the polyhedron QG, the convexal of the permutation schedules, is its base polytope. So that's a bounded polyhedron. Furthermore, Smith's rule is up to an affine transformation, the same affine transformation, simply the greedy algorithm for supermodular polyhedron. So, and we can see this transformation here. The optimum value is the minimum for any weights W, which would be, we'll take as strictly positive. This, by simply letting a change of variables where Xj is Pj times Cj, then it's the minimization of the inverse of the Smith ratio, Wj over Pj. Subject to this constraint that defined the supermodular polyhedron. The sum of variables over any subset is greater than or equal to this right-hand side function. So this is just, in a sense, Smith's rule is an early version of the greedy algorithm for a particular type of supermodular polyhedron. So let's go one step beyond by introducing precedence constraints. So if we add precedence constraints to a scheduling problem, we get immediately a problem that's NP hard in general. However, we can say something about these problems. In particular, we can generalize the simple precedence constraints. So the simple precedence constraints are those we had in the earlier discussion about the disjunctions. This constraint can be generalized by looking at subsets of jobs. So J is a subset of jobs. Every job in the set J precedes every job in the set K. So we say that the subset J, the whole subset precedes the whole subset K. So when we have such a pair of subsets, then the following inequality is valid. So we take the, now we have something that's even stranger than before. So we have the total processing time of the set J times the sum of the products of the processing times and completion times over the set K minus the converse quantity, exchanging K and J, greater than or equal to a function H, which depends on both sets J and K, and which is defined by, for example, by the expression below. So these inequalities are valid inequalities. And furthermore, in the work with Yaoquang Wang, we show that a directed graph with the jobs as nodes and the precedence constraints as arcs, such a graph is series parallel if and only if for any positive processing times, the scheduling polyhedron is defined by the parallel inequalities, so the inequalities we had before, and for any subsets of jobs and the series inequality for all pairs of subsets J preceding K. So that's a characterization of this polyhedra for series parallel. So in other words, this theorem implies that the scheduling polyhedron for series parallel precedence constraint is completely defined by these two families of inequalities. Now, since we have again a set of inequalities, the series inequalities, which is large, which is maybe exponentially large. So the separation problem for these inequalities which is given a candidate vector C, does it satisfy all these inequalities or not? This problem is easy when the presence constraints are series parallel, which was shown by Andreas Schultz. It's NP-hard for general presence constraints. That's a problem that had been open for some time and was resolved by Kobayashi and others in 2012. This might be a bit surprising, even though it's NP-hard in general, we have a polynomial time separation algorithm for a larger class of inequalities, which contains those all the series parallel inequalities and possibly others, from an extended formulation using additional variables, the linear ordering variables that I mentioned earlier. So if you have a vector which violates some series parallel inequalities, then it will fail some inequality in the larger class that was defined in the work of Woolsey. If it satisfies all of them, then it might violate some other inequalities resulting from that class, but certainly not one of them. So that's an example of a class of inequalities for which separation is NP-hard, but where the separation for a larger class is actually tractable in polynomial time. We performed some computational experiments on precedence constrained single machine scheduling problems based on random instances using heuristic separation for series inequalities. We found that the relaxation gap is less than 1%. So the optimality gap is less than 1% for instances of size up to 160 that we tested the work with Yang Wang. And later with François Margot, we developed a branch and cut algorithm, which allowed us to solve to exact optimality instances up to 120 jobs. Now there has been lots of following work on precedence constraints inequalities in terms of characterizing facets that come from different structures and pass precedence constraints to dimensional Gantt charts and so on. That I will not discuss this, and I will now turn to sort of change pace. So the original motivation by Balash and the work that we did up to the mid-1990s was structural, describing the polyhedra associated with scheduling problems and leading to exact solution by, let's say, separation algorithms, cutting planes, branch and cut types of algorithms. And when we presented that work in the mid-1990s, Joel Wine and Cliff Stein asked, well, these results about scheduling polyhedra, could they be useful to derive approximation algorithms for scheduling problems with a priori performance guarantee? And this was answered positively by Andreas Schultz in the following lemma. So if you take only the parallel inequalities, so you have a vector C that satisfies the parallel inequalities, any such vector, and you use that vector to construct a feasible schedule by least scheduling. So simply insert the jobs in the order of the component vectors. Then you obtain a feasible schedule, which that's denoted with completion times denoted by CL, L as in least scheduling, which satisfy the job by job bounds. For every job, the completion time in the least schedule is no more than twice the value that you started from, provided that this vector C satisfies the parallel inequalities. So you have a factor of two here. So this implies both that the linear program, well, that the bound that you get by solving a linear program that includes the parallel inequalities is at least half of the optimum, and the least schedule that you obtain by this simple method is at most twice the optimum for the single machine problem with precedence constraints. In fact, there is a much stronger result, which is that every feasible schedule which is consistent with a certain decomposition that was introduced by Jeff Sidney in the 1970s is in fact also too approximate. So this inequality is also true for any such feasible schedule that was shown independently by Chekuri and Motwani and by ourselves, the work with François Marmont. Now, these type of approximation algorithms have been the object of many extensions and related work on various scheduling environments. And here we'll mention some asymptotic optimality consequences of that. Okay, so let's turn to problems with release dates. So when you have a release date RJ, a job only becomes available for processing at its release date. So these release dates may be different for different jobs. In the classical offline problems, the release dates and all the problem data are known from the beginning. So you know in advance that at a certain date, a job will arrive that has this processing time and this weight and these other characteristics. In online problem, one only learns about the characteristic of a job, including its release date, or even its existence, at when the job appears at its release date, when it's being released. Before that, you don't know anything about that job. Well, the bad news is that the offline problem with release on one machine with release dates and minimizing the mean sum objective, weighted sum of completion times is NP hard. So what can we say about this? Well, one simple heuristic, the natural extension of the of Smith's rule, of the weighted shortest processing time, is the weighted shortest processing time among available jobs. So among jobs that are available for processing, when you make a processing decision, take one that has the best WSPT ratio, the ratio of processing time to weight. So that's a very natural heuristic. Well, it's very natural, but it can be arbitrarily bad, even when you have two jobs. Very simple instances show that. However, I will show that this simple heuristic is asymptotically optimal. So what does asymptotically optimal mean? So if you have an instance class J and you define the size of an instance, which is denoted by I here, then the asymptotic optimality is the limit supremum when the size of the instance grows of the ratio of the objective value of the solution resulting from the algorithm H to the optimum Z star of I for every instance I. So that limit supremum is equal to one. In other words, the in relative terms, the heuristic produces solutions that have an objective value which is arbitrarily close to the optimum when the size is sufficiently large. And for the scheduling problems that we consider here, we'll take the number of jobs as being the size of an instance. So we let the number of jobs grow. So why are we interested in asymptotic optimality? Well, there's a number of reasons. So first, the traditional performance measures of algorithms like performance ratio or approximation ratio for deterministic or randomized algorithms, competitive ratio for online algorithms. These performance measures are pessimistic, they're conservative, they're focused on the worst case, the worst that can happen. So when they give a fairly negative value, that means that there exist bad instances. But these bad instances, often they are either very small or they are contrived, they have extreme data values. So as a consequence, most results tend to have limited practical value because they focus on the worst that can happen, which can be fairly contrived. And it's been observed that on large instances, uncontrived instances, simple heuristics may be empirically better than heuristics which were designed for optimizing a performance ratio or competitive ratio. So for example, as we'll see, heuristics based on Smith ratio rule, some extensions of this may empirically perform better. And this was seen, for example, in the computational work of Martin Schabelsberg and others. And in addition, asymptotic optimality is a property which has been known and is well accepted in the study of stochastic processes and stochastic control. So we'll focus for a little while now on asymptotic optimality. So first, we showed that this algorithm, weighted shortest processing time among available jobs, is asymptotically optimal for every uniformly bounded instance class of the single machine problem with release date, the online problem with release dates and weighted sum of completion times. So a uniformly bounded instance is one where there exists a priori bounds, constant bounds, that that upper positive lower bound and the upper bounds on every parameter, which here would be the release dates and the processing times and the weights. So for every such uniformly bounded class of instances, the this algorithm is asymptotically optimal. So it gives solutions that are arbitrarily close to the optimum in the relative term for large instances. The proof uses an LP relaxation with a decomposition of the objective using so-called priority work sets and a work delay lemma. So it's expanding what information you generate from the LP relaxation. This result extends to parallel machines and in fact to uniform parallel machines. So it's also asymptotically optimum for every uniformly bounded instance. So here the speeds are also bounded when we have a fixed set of uniform machines. So the number of machines does not vary. Furthermore, this also extends to certain form of stochastic online scheduling. So in stochastic scheduling, or stochastic online scheduling, we assume that you have processing times that are random variables. We're going to assume that they are independent and that we know only the weight, which in this class here is known, and the expected processing time. So only the first moment of the distribution of processing times. And they are, in the online versions, they're only known when the job appears at its release date. So we're going to consider scheduling policies. So whenever there is a decision, processing decisions to be made, the scheduling policies specifies what to do next, maybe which job to process or whether to wait until something happens. And such a scheduling policy is adaptive if it can use any information available at a certain date for making a decision at that date, but no information about the future that is not available at that time. And it's weakly and non-anticipative if it does not know the processing time of a job before the job completes. So you may have a job that starts operate, it's processing on a machine. So long as it processes, you don't know its exact processing time. This may be relevant in problems where you have parallel machines, for example. So the WESPTA algorithm is the natural extension of the previous algorithm, weighted expected shortest processing time algorithm, where you replace the processing time by the expected processing times and among available jobs. This algorithm is asymptotically optimal relative to the class of all adaptive and weakly non-anticipative policies for every, again, uniformly bounded instance class of the problem where you have random processing times and the online problems with release dates and random processing times that I've described earlier and the weighted sum of completion time objective. And the proof of this theorem uses, again, the machine capacity constraints that we described much earlier, a preemptive version of WSPT algorithm applied to a deterministic instance where we use expected processing time, a chain of bound and a notion of work delay that's derived from the machine capacity constraints. Now let's turn to shop scheduling problems. So here each job consists of operations, M operations, one for each machine. And it's with the operation I must be processed on the ith machine. machine MI, and the processing time is random variable. So we have a random vector. We assume that these vectors are independent. And Shia, Shantikumar, and Glynn showed that they introduced the notion of statistically exchangeable processing times across machines. If for every permutations of the machines, the random vectors of processing times have the same distribution. So we showed that the WESPT algorithms using expected short processing times among available jobs, when it's extended to flow shops and open shop problems, is asymptotically optimal relative to the class of all adaptive and weakly non-anticipative policies as before, and for every uniformly bounded instance class with independent job processing time vectors that are statistically exchangeable across machines. So we need that notion. And in that case, then this WESPTA algorithm is asymptotically optimal. Okay, so let's get back to deterministic shop scheduling problem, and I'll mention a very general result that allows one to approximate mean sum objectives using mixed span. So relationship between the two most popular classes of objectives, mixed span and mean sum objectives in scheduling. This is work with Maxim Sviridenko. So here we consider shop scheduling problems that have multiple stages. A stage is a collection of parallel machines. Yeah. So in stage H, you have MH parallel machines. You have jobs. A job is a collection of operations. So operations OHJ is an operation J on of job J on stage H. It has known processing time, PHJ, known release dates. There may be precedence constraints between these operations or precedence delays. And in addition, we model a general class of objectives by introducing sets of operations. So you have a set S of operation. The completion time of that set is the largest completion time of the operations in the set. So this allows us to model simultaneously what's individual operation plus completion times when the set consists only of that single operation, job completion times where the set is the set of all operations of a job, stage loads where the set is the set of all operations on a stage, and so on. And each such set has a weight WS. So assume that we have a raw approximation for the make span problem for this type of shop scheduling problems. Make span problems, we don't need the algorithm to deal with release dates. Then we can develop an LP relaxation. The variables are the operation completion times. There are constraints for the release dates. Simple precedence constraints. We have stage capacity constraints, the parallel inequalities that we introduced earlier for each stage, taking into account the fact that they are parallel machines. And a new class of capacity constraints, which are the job capacity constraints, which also allows to consider a job as a resource, as a set of operations. And because the operations on the job in these types of environment must be cannot overlap, then we have a corresponding capacity constraint. So when we can set up this LP relaxation and we can use that LP relaxation to devise an approximation algorithm for the minimizing the weighted sum of set completion times. And that we can show that if we have such a raw approximation algorithm for the make span, we can obtain a 2E raw approximation for the min sum objective. So 2E is approximately 5.4, E is the base of the natural logarithms. So this is a very general reduction of min sum objectives, make span objectives with a relatively modest loss in approximation value. Okay, so this is what I wanted to say about formulations and polyhedra and the consequences, structural insights and algorithmic insights we can derive when we use completion times or stop time variables. Now let's turn to time-indexed formulations. So there are a number of issues associated with time-indexed formulations. So a time-indexed formulation is one in which you discretize the horizon over which scheduling will happen, and you associate a variable, typically a binary variable, with every operation and also every time period at which this operation might happen. So there are two types of general issues with time index formulations. The first one is that if the number of time periods is large, then these formulations will tend to be very large. This type of formulations tend to give very tight bounds, tighter bounds than many other types of formulations. There are a number of different approaches to deal with the size issue, such as column generation, different sorts of mathematical programming decompositions, more recently dynamic discretization discoveries that was developed by Natasha Boland and Martin Schavelsberg and their associates. But I've not worked on this, so I will turn to a type of problems where we use time-indexed formulations associated with the switch-on and switch-off operations on machines. So here, this is a type of problem that arises in a number of different contexts in power generation. It's known as commitment problems, unit commitment problems. So here we'll focus on a single unit. Also in production planning, when you turn machines on and off. So again, single product machine production planning. So type of problems that we got interested in when working on mine scheduling problems. On both underground mine scheduling, so-called draw point scheduling, and also in some types of open pit scheduling problems. So all this type of issues arise there. So let's set up the corresponding model. So we have a finite discrete time horizon T, which goes from 1 to n. So here I use n to denote the number of periods. So we don't have jobs in this particular type of scheduling problems. So n is the number of periods, and n is a moderately large number such that we can handle formulations that are, say, with variables and constraints linear in n. We have one machine, and that machine has two states. It's either on or off. In each period, it can be on or off, and we'll use a binary variable yt, which is equal to 1 if the machine is on in period t, and 0 if it is off. We are given an initial state y naught, and we may have some earlier history that may be relevant, for example, in terms of how many time units the machine has been in that state y naught. So in each period t, we have two possible actions. We can switch on the machine if it was off in the previous period, and if it's on in period t, then we can define a binary variable zt, which is equal to 1, and it's 0 otherwise. So we could also leave the machine off during that period. If it is on, we can switch it off, and we have a corresponding binary variable wt, which is equal to 1 in that case, or we can leave it off during that period. In that case, wt is equal to 0. So here we've defined three binary variables associated with each period. And this is a classical model in the unit commitment literature that goes back to the 1960s, the Garvey. It's known as the three bin model. So here you can observe that Zt is simply the positive part of the difference between yt and yt minus 1. Wt is the positive part of the negative of that difference. And as a result, the difference between Zt and Wt is just equal to the difference between yt and yt minus 1. In other words, you have thanks to the last equation. If you know two of the binary variables, then you can derive the third one immediately by this linear equation. So if you use this equation to eliminate one of the variables. And typically we stay with two variables, such as the state variable y and the switch on variable z, and the switch of variable w is implied by this equation. We can also be interested in a one-bin model where we have only the y state variable. The advantage of this will be that we get more compact models. So many optimization problems associated with this type of situation can be modeled by dynamic programming in a fairly straightforward way. So we have two types of nodes associated with each period corresponding to the on or off state of each machine. And we have the transitions that go from on or off when we associated with intervals. So for example, here we have a machine which is initially off in period one, and then it's on, so we turn it on at the beginning of period two, and it remains on for three periods, so from two to four. And then in period five, we change, we switch the machine off in period five. So it's been on in periods two, three, and four. And then it's off in periods five and six. We turn it off in period six. So it's on in period seven and so on. So we have the corresponding transitions, the denoted here by the variables x, I, j, with a superscript, which is equal to one if we corresponding to turning the machine on, and two corresponding to turning the machine off. And we, with this type of formulation, we can model a fairly general objective function. The only constraint here is that it be additive over the intervals. So that's, so the total objective value is the sum of the objective values over the various intervals, on and off intervals. And we may have general constraints on the individual intervals. So it's a fairly general approach. So this dynamic program is essentially a shortest path problem. And the standard shortest path formulation, which is a tight extended formulation, has of the order of n square binary variables, the flow variables. We have an n square flow variables. And we have a linear set of flow balance equations, constraints at every node. And the question that we consider here is whether we can obtain tight formulations with a linear number of variables, either in the two bin or the one bin model. So using only YZ variables or using only the Y variables. So is it possible to devise constraints that allow this instead of having n square binary variables? So for moderate values of n, linear number of variables might be tractable, but in quadratic number of variables might be a bit too much. And this is what we try to avoid. And we consider here a class of problems where we have bounded on and off times. That is, we're given bounds on the length of the intervals. So we're given lower and upper bounds on the length of an on interval starting in period t. So that an interval that starts in period t must have a length of at least alpha t and at most beta t. And similarly, we have lower and upper bounds, gamma and delta, on the length of off intervals starting in period t. These bounds, so here you notice that there's an index t, they may be non-stationary, and they may be adjusted to take into account initial conditions, particularly history, how long the machine has been in its initial state, and possibly terminal conditions that we may specify. So here is a natural mixed integer programming formulation that you'll find in one form or another in many problems, particularly in the unit commitment literature and also in some of the production planning literature. So here we have, it's a three bin model. We have the three types of variables. So we call that Y is the state variable, on or off. Z is the switch on variables, W is the switch off variable. So the first set of constraints here relate Z and Y. And essentially, they can be viewed as a McCormick linearization of the nonlinear constraint, the product quadratic constraint, that Zt is equal to the product of Yt and 1 minus Yt minus 1. And this simply says that ZT can only be 1 if YT is equal to 1 and YT minus 1 is equal to 0. Otherwise, it has to be 0. The next constraint expresses the lower bounds on the intervals. The next set of constraints expresses the lower bound, the upper bounds on the on intervals, then the lower bounds on the off intervals, and the lower bound on the upper bound, on the off intervals. And finally, this last constraint here is links the W variables with the Y and Z variables, links all three sets of variables together. And this is with binary variables, the three bin variables. So this is a standard formulation that you'll find. And a first observation is that, well, we can get very simply a tighter formulation. So if you look at the forward-looking lower bound constraints as they were expressed, which says that, that's in constraint five, that if a variable was in is in state one at the period is off, so if YU is equal to zero, then it cannot have been turned on in an earlier period in the alpha t preceding period, alpha t minus one preceding period. Well, we can replace this constraint, so which look forward. So if another way of looking at this constraint is if Z is equal to one, then for the next alpha t periods, then the machine must be on. But we can replace this with a backward-looking constraint, which is that the constraint 11 says that if the machine is off in period t, then it must have been turned, it cannot have been turned on in any of the preceding period. So you see that this constraint here is looks a bit stronger than the previous one, because on the small side of the inequality, you have a summation of variables instead of individual variables. So it's, in a sense, it's an aggregated constraint, an aggregated version of the previous one. So it's tighter. And similarly for the lower bounds on the off intervals, we have a corresponding set of inequalities. So the resulting formulation is tighter than the previous one. And this simple observation generalizes results that you could find in Woods' book or in a paper by Rajan and Takriti on a unit commitment problem with bounded on and off intervals, generalizes those results from fixed bounds to non-stationary lower bounds. And then, since we have a tighter formulation, we can ask, when is such formulation ideal? When is it ideal in the three-bin space or the two-bin space of the state and switch and variables, or even in the one-bin space of those variables? So we will consider a generalized version of this question by taking any subset of bounds, any subset of bound types in force. So we let Z of, so B is any subset of bounds. So we might include lower bounds. We might on intervals, upper bounds on intervals, lower bounds on off intervals, upper bounds on off intervals, any subset of these four types of constraints. ZB is the corresponding set of binary vectors satisfying these constraints. And YB is the projection of these vectors. So vectors that satisfy these constraints and all the previous constraints. So if we have an empty set, then an empty set of constraints, then the corresponding polyhedron in the YZ space is simply those that satisfy the constraints 2 to 4, the McCormick relationship between Y and Z. And the projection is a set of 4, 0, 1 vectors. All states are possible in that case if there are no constraints. Furthermore, it's easy to see that in the YZ space, the corresponding polyhedron for B is the intersection of the polyhedra. The set of binary vectors is the intersection of the binary vectors corresponding to each one of the bounds in the set. That's just essentially by definition. But maybe more surprisingly, the corresponding projection is the intersection of the projections. when that set is not empty. That the last case requires some proof. Now, we will introduce one restriction on the bounds, which is what we call weak monotonicity. So the bounds satisfy weak monotonicity if whenever you have two time units t and u, t is less than u, then t plus epsilon t, so the when epsilon is a lower bound, then that's the earliest date that corresponding to an interval that starts in t. When these adjusted times, so t plus epsilon t, is less than or equal to the adjusted time u plus epsilon u. So in other words, if we wait one period or more, so waiting one period is when u is t plus one, then we cannot be forced to switch on the machine or switch it off earlier due to the bounds. So this weak monotonicity property will be used. So for any type of bound and any period, we will define the earliest start period of a of an interval, of an appropriate interval, on interval, if the bounds are for the on lower or upper bounds on the on intervals or the off intervals, the earliest start period of an interval that may end after t. And we have to adjust this definition when the bounds are when the lower bounds do not belong to that. So we let then these bounds to be equal to one, and the and similarly for the upper bound. So there is some technical adjustment in the definition of these earlier start periods for these special cases. And weak monotonicity implies that if you have an interval u, a period u which is in the interval between the earlier start period epsilon t and t, then this happens if and only if u plus epsilon u is greater than t. So these conditions allow us to derive the following formulation. So in this formulation here, we fix the initial conditions in 35, and the switching condition correspond to the state switch on condition correspond to the state in 35. Then we have the inequality defining ZT. We have the lower bound, the constraint 37 correspond to the lower bound constraint on non-interval, 38 on the upper bound constraint on non-interval, and similarly for 39 and 40 for the off interval, and then we relax the integrating constraint on y and z to each one of those variables between 0 and 1. So if you consider this formulation here, this polyhedron, then under the weak monotonicity condition, this set of inequalities defines an ideal formulation of the corresponding polyhedron. In other words, this polyhedron is a convex set, the convex hull of the set of y z vectors that satisfy these bounds. How do we prove this? So I'll skip this part. We introduce integer count variables, and we show that there is we can define in terms of these new variables a polyhedron which is defined by totally unimodular constraint matrix. So it's an extended formulation, and then it's ideal. And so that implies that this polyhedra are integral, and this is a derivation of earlier results that were obtained only for stationary lower bound that generalizes it to upper bounds and to non-stationary bounds. And we can also answer the question in the one bin space of the single variables by looking at alternating inequalities. I will skip the details here and the proof. And again, we use dynamic programming in order to both prove the fact that we get the an ideal formulation, and also obtain a linear time separation algorithm for these sets of these exponential sets of alternating inequalities. And turns out if we have only upper bounds, then the solution is much simpler. It's given by a simple explicit set of inequalities in the Y space. So we don't need alternating inequalities. And we can combine also the lower bound types, so we can combine the upper bound types, and we don't need new facets, new inequalities when we project onto the Y subspace. So this concludes my talk, I think just in time. Indicating some open questions here. If you have considered, for example, only bounds on the uninterals, but both lower and upper bounds, then the problem is not well understood. The convex hull is not well understood. We have identified new types of inequalities that are valid, that are facet defining when the period is sufficiently far from the beginning and the end. And finally, we know that if we can characterize the convex hull for lower and upper bounds on the uninterals, then by time reversal, we can characterize the corresponding polyhedron for bounds on the off intervals. So that concludes my talk. I have included some references, and then including a references to a survey that Andreas Schultz and I wrote in 1994, and some of the references of the work that I mentioned here, with apologies to the authors for many omissions in this list here. I'm done.
Okay, Maurice, thank you very much. I allowed all participants to unmute. So if anybody wants to ask a question, then he or she is allowed to do so. Just step in and ask, right? If nobody is ready, then let me ask the first one. So some of these problems are kind of time symmetric so that we can solve them on a reverse time axis. For example, something like backward scheduling used, I think, in RCPSP and so. So and this is kind of symmetry of the polytop, right? Which identifies a set of feasible solutions. So maybe you have some references related to that as well.
Okay, so in the type of scheduling problems that we consider, we allow the insertion of idle times, which is the reason why, at the very beginning, I mentioned Balassi's very first result that these polyhedra are unbounded. Uh-huh. And so time reversal does not really apply to that case. However, time reversal
is unbounded, that clearly it's not time symmetric, right?
Yeah. So you can bound things, you can bound them a priori. For example, if you know that it's, for example, on one machine, it's optimum not to have any idle time, then we get the scheduling polytope in the case of a single machine, a simple case, which is indeed invariant under time reversal. Or you could view it also as the intersection of two unbounded polyhedra, the supermodular polyhedron that was defined there, and then a submodular polyhedron, which is below that, which corresponds essentially to time reversal. So we can do that. If we may have idle time, for example, in shop scheduling problems, where that may be forced, that we could introduce some deadlines, for example, to bound everything, and then those deadlines will then induce new inequalities, which are of a type which is very similar to the inequalities that we've seen in this talk. However, if those deadlines are not large enough, they may also interfere with the other part of the let's say the early part of the schedules, and then induce new, maybe artificial constraints and so on. So, but if those deadlines are sufficiently large, then they induce a structure on the upper part of the scheduling polyhedra, which is very similar to the first one.
Okay.
So that's comment. Another comment here is that, in fact, in what I've presented here, we use time reversals in two places. I mentioned it just in the next to last slide, in the last slide, actually, or before the references, where we use the time reversal to show the obvious fact that if we have bounds on the on intervals, then it's equivalent to have bounds on the off intervals. It's a sort of time reversal. And also in the early part of the talk, I mentioned the series inequalities, which have two sets of jobs, a set of job J, which precedes a set of job K. One way of deriving the validity of this series inequalities is by time reversal, by inserting a time period, which is to be determined, between the completion of all the jobs in the first set and the start of all the jobs in the second set, and then we have deriving inequalities on the second set, which are the parallel inequalities, but also inequalities on the first set relative to that date, which are obtained by time reversal, starting from that date. So that's another use of time reversal in that.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. So any other question?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes,
perfect, thank you. I have two questions. First is from one viewer on the YouTube channel, and he is asking, on slide 34, you define S underscore R as a minimum of inequalities. What do you mean by that?
So that's in the chat?
Yeah, that's in the YouTube chat. I can resend the question. It's on slide 34. There's some definition S underscore R, and the question is, what is meant by it, basically?
S underscore B, I think. Yes. So that's the, S underscore B is the earliest start period of an interval that may, so that the earlier start period relative to a particular bound, lower or upper bound, on or off interval, and relative also to a period T. And this is the earliest start period of a non, depending on the bound, that of an interval on or off, depending on the type of the bound, that satisfies the corresponding bound, and that may end after T.
I see.
After T. Yes, so that's, I think the definition is given explicitly in that slide 34. And this interval, earlier start period is used in the next slide in defining the lower limit of the summations in the inequalities 37 to 40. So in these summations here, we look at the all the time intervals that start at this earlier start date and that finish in T in those inequalities 37 to 40, but also in 39 and 40, we relate that the switch on decisions or the sum of the switch on decisions to the state in the earliest date period. So that's these earliest start dates are used in this four inequalities, which model the bounds on the on and off intervals.
I see. Thank you for the explanation. Then I would have one question of my own, and it is in regards to the asymptotical optimality. If I understood correctly, we want to use this metric instead of the approximation ratio, because the idea is that it's sometimes more representative of the quality of some algorithm or like algorithm basically. However, when we are comparing the ratios of the algorithm when we are have like this limit supremum that the algorithms for the like infinitely large instance will have the same performance, then this is of course not realistic in the real world, right? The instance must be somehow limited in the size. So my question is, how do we estimate what is this large instance in a real world problem? So this metric is like still relevant. So it can happen that this would be true for such huge instances that it wouldn't matter in the real world, right? So is there like a way how to assess this?
Yes. So you would have to look at the specific results, the specific proofs, which generally will give some bound on, let's say, the value of n. The way this ratio zh over z star depends on the bound n, on the low, let's say, minimize the upper bound on this ratio, how it depends on n. In other words, what you want to know, and I think typically the proofs will give that, is some value of the relative regret, so ZH minus Z star divided by Z star, the way that the rate at which that relative regret goes to zero. And that that will give you some indication on how quickly you approach that optimality as the size grows.
I see.
And the results are typically, or can typically be derived by the bounds, either explicitly or implicitly from the bounds, from the proofs.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay. Any other question? If not, then let me thank to Maurice. It was great, really. And let me also mention that we are entering holidays period, so there will be no seminar in July and August, but we will start with the seminars again somewhere in September. I don't know exactly when and exactly who will speak the first. We will have at least some conversation with PC members. They will suggest the speakers, and then we will vote for speakers. So stay tuned, and I will send you information in start of September so that you can again join. Okay. So thank you very much for attending the seminar, and I hope that you will join us again in September, and we will have again very inspirative speakers and very nice talks. Guohua, would you like to say something as well?
No, I just want to say thank all the speakers. Maurice, thank you very much for the excellent presentation. And then we want to see you in September. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, and bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Okay, thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Bye-bye.